you're done, crucify.
Is this one?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's it.
Our next step is to visit the field,
Having already assembled a missionary team and trained among national pastors, we then began daily soul winning and nightly evangelistic services leading up to that exciting opening day of the new church. Our calling is to start independent Baptist churches from those that we win to Jesus Christ. We are also to start Bible colleges and Bible institutes to continue to train these and future generations. Although just now focusing on raising our much-needed support, I'd like to share with you what I have been doing during the first 15 months of this global ministry. Jesus himself said in Matthew 9, 37, 38, these words, which I have personally seen to be true. Then saith he to his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. There are souls ready to be saved, but we must go. And to go, we must have your help. In May of 2014, we traveled to India for a five-week missionary journey. During this time, we saw God blessed with 1,289 Indian people coming to Jesus Christ. I remember a story where I was mentoring a young lady to become a soul winner. Her name was Sarah. She was nearly 17 years of age. When we were dropped off at the church bus to go soul winning in the park, this young lady was able to win her first 8 souls to Jesus Christ this day. Matthew 9:37 said, then said to his disciples, his harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. We want to praise God for the results during the first 15 months of missionary ministry. Certainly all glory goes to the glorious grace of God. We have seen at the time of this recording 12,512 souls saved. 28 churches have been started, 2 Bible colleges, 1 school in Pakistan, with 420 men and women having walked the aisles to become missionaries. Let me take a moment to share another aspect of our ministry, which we call our Skype ministry. Skype is an internet social media outlet that is a text, voice, and video program. This makes it simple to talk with people all over the world. While we are preaching evangelistically on Skype, we call this our Skypeistic services. And then when we are teaching, we simply call this our discipleship ministry. By the grace of God, we have started 9 churches in Pakistan as a result of this type of ministry and have trained many national preachers through this additional vehicle to reach the world globally each day. We have now, by the grace of God, started 10 churches through Skype. I really need your help to allow us to do our part in reaching the world with the gospel. Here's what I'm clearly asking God's people to do. First, pray with us as we are teaching and preaching anywhere from 5 to 6, sometimes even 8 or 9 times a week, sometimes 2 to 3 times a day. Second, I need your help by allowing us to come to present this ministry to your church. Could you contact me at 317-432-1499, or you can contact me at my email address, jimkilmerministries@gmail.com, to schedule a meeting. We are winning souls daily. We are starting churches. We are starting Bible colleges and Bible institutes. But we need you to become a part of our team. Together. This is a key word, together. Every great ministry has had several such partners to help. Will you help us? I make this appeal upon the basis of the call of God for the rest of my life, in reaching all 7 continents for Jesus Christ.
Along with that, I want to say from the wife's standpoint, which we hear so much from our missionary guys that sometimes the ladies are right there, but I appreciate this opportunity. We ask you to pray for safety as we travel. I have not been internationally traveling with my husband, but this August we'll have, the entire month of August will be gone, and I'm going to be able to go with it. I'm excited. I want to meet some of these ladies and guys that I've been seeing on Skype and talking with and seeing. I want to be able to minister to them and they to me. And so I'm really excited about that, see what the Lord will do. We're going to be in Hong Kong, Taiwan, and Philippines during that trip. So it will be busy. I'm really excited to do that. I've been able to go just about everywhere in the United States with him, but this is my first international trip. When you are praying and thinking about your missionaries, I want to ask you to, number one, pray for them. And maybe specifically, not just, Lord bless our missionary, Mr. and Mrs. So-and-so, and there's your children in such and such a country. They are real people, and they're depending on your prayers and your continued support. And as much as you want and expect to hear from them what's going on, how are they doing, they also totally love hearing from your church. For instance, we just had a revival. We have a new members. We're having a Bible camp. Something that will encourage them and let them know, because they think of you as their partners in church family when you're supporting them and obligated to them. So pray for them specifically. There have been several times that we needed prayer for safety. Jim's life has been threatened maybe about four times in different countries. Seriously, not just somebody watching him. And so that's a little difficult for the wife to accept that and put that in the Lord's hands. One specific thing I'll tell you that helped me the second trip I believe he was on, he was right in the middle of the biggest hurricane the Philippines had ever seen. I was on my face in the living room praying. And I had peace after that. What can I do? What else can I do? I've given it over. I know that you're going to take care of it. But still, I was wavering a little bit in my faith. I have to admit that. And I thought, what can I do? Well, I'll go to Hobby Lobby. That always makes me happy. So I did. I said, I can't just sit around here and stew. So I went to Hobby Lobby, and I don't think I bought anything, but it was interesting and fun. The things that I saw, our pastor's wife and some of his family, she said, oh, honey, how are you doing? I said, it's not very well. You know, and I kind of just let a few tears out. But really, that was about it. The rest of the time, my friend called me and said, do you really believe God can take care of you? I said, well, absolutely, I do. And she said, well, you're saying that, but you're still so emotional. I said, I know. Can you take care of them and they're the same as at your dining room table? And I said, yes. And I just got calm. And I just didn't have any more tears. I didn't continue to pray, but I just needed that cheek to say, you say that, but is that really true? And it proved that I do believe that's really true. And when you're praying specifically for the missionary and his wife and their children, it is good to pray specifically. Let them know. Find out what they like. Does she have a favorite fragrance she can't get it? You know, put together a little box, a little something. Does somebody have an allergy? Does somebody have a special need? Those kind of things that are coming, let them know that you're praying for them specifically and that you care about them. Not just that they're a picture or on your bulletin, that they are a real couple, a family, serving God in a different way. Our ministry is a little different as well. We didn't travel different places. We still continue to do that, but not a lot. As my husband spoke yesterday, people have their routines in their church, and it doesn't always include having the missionaries in. recording some, they're not thinking about you. But sometimes just by presenting the ministry and what's been going on, it can bless someone. It can inspire and encourage them with who are, they already have in their support. And it may lay at the church's heart or an individual to say, you know, I've been praying for this country and he's already going there by Skype and next year we'll be there. That's something that we think about, not just going around raising support, but presenting the ministry of what God is doing and has called us to do. So I just wanted to say thank you so much for having us back and allowing us to present the ministry, and hopefully it will encourage you that God works all over the world, here in Lebanon, in the United States, elsewhere. He came and died for the world. And that's all I'm going to say. Thank you.
Tonight, I just want to give just a few minute sort of update to the video. We had that shot at Thomas Anderson College. They were very nice to do that for us for free. And so that was a blessing. But to give you an update, when you start a ministry, you think you know exactly what God wants you to do, right? But in the process, you know, it's not that God evolves, but our understanding of God's call evolves. When we started out as a soul winning and a church planting ministry. But it wasn't long until we realized that we needed to have a ministry to the preachers that was going to start churches with us long before we ever got to the field. We sort of learned some things the hard way, but I've come to realize the value of teaching and training pastors. For example, this last trip in Uganda and Kenya, we were able to work with these preachers for 7.5 months for about 2.5 hours on Saturday. As a result of that, when we got down to about 1 month before, then I instructed them to go out, start evangelizing, passing out some flyers, letting them know that we are going to start a church. And we had the name of the man that was going to be the pastor. Then when we got there, we got the team together, bless you, and we were able to evangelize. And on that trip alone, we were able to start 14 independent Fundamental Baptist churches, and we praise God for that. But then what's evolved is, what's the next steps? It's great to start a church, but then you just walk away, and you trust that the whatever months of training that you had is going to do it. And so what we do is we stay in contact with them for a long period of time. Our ministry supports different people that are starting churches for us, and regional guys that's monitoring the churches to help us hear. Okay, seems like you can. And could you all hear me back there? Okay, good. And so one of the things that has evolved in this ministry as well is the need for continued education for the pastors. I was able to go to Indiana Baptist College. You was able to go to Indiana or Heritage then, right? Heritage Baptist University. Did you go there or something? Okay. And so we had some great opportunities. But these guys, they don't. You know, sometimes they step into the pulpit, they know very little. They haven't had the opportunity for training, and they haven't had maybe a mentor to guide them and teach them along the way. So we come to appreciate the fact that one thing that we can do is to start Bible institutes for these people to make sure that they're continuing to grow in Bible doctrines, pastoral theology, expository teaching and preaching, personal evangelism, Christian leadership. And so that's what we do. Something else that's evolved, and I'll be done, you can get ready in about 90 seconds, is October 1st, 2014, got down with my heart, because my goal was to try to win one person every week to the Lord. And what I'm sharing with you is not something to make you feel bad if you're not doing it, because all these years I did. I'm just telling you what I was doing and how God dealt with me. But in the Philippines on October 1st, 2014, God dealt with my heart about trying to lead at least one person to Jesus Christ every single day for the rest of my life. And so to hold myself accountable, I got a spreadsheet every day, I write down, you know, day by day, saved, whatever, then at the end of the year, I track how many people got saved, not only for the year, but also the percentage of days, so I can hold myself accountable. Last year, by the grace of God, we saw 91% of every day, and then somebody got saved. And we praise God for that. But that's something that's evolved in this missionary ministry. I'm going to be honest right now. I didn't want to share this, but I think the way God is dealing with my heart now is to increase, when I'm here in America, is to increase the number of days that I'm personally going out, knocking on doors, trying to win people to Jesus Christ rather than doing once or twice a week. But now, you know, this time this I got, listen to you. Do you want me to say go out 1 hour every single day? Or are you saying that you want me to personally talk and pass out a tract to at least 10 different people where I can talk to every day? But I just want to make sure that our missionary ministry is also here when we're home as well. And we do win people to the Lord, quite a few, by the grace of God. However, we want to do more. Now, one other thing that I'd like to share, or two more things I'd like to share, is last year, 2017, without a goal, we were able to personally take out and train 75 people that led their first person to Jesus Christ. I say, I know pastors and people or pretend that he's a new member or a new convert or whatever, so I teach him soul winning for a few weeks. Then I say, now I want you to go out with me. I want you to watch me. So I take him out. And then it's his turn, and I'm there. And I don't count him as one until he actually leads somebody to the Lord in front of me so that I know that they understand how to be a soul winner. And they gave me the idea of setting a goal for 100 people this year. And right now, as of May 31st, as 5 months, we've had 55 new people that's won at least one person to the Lord. Now, one guy that we trained last year has already won here in America. You know, we took him out, shared with him how to win people to the Lord. We take no credit. But because there was another pastor that was involved too, we thank God for that. But the bottom line is he's already won over 230 people to the Lord in Florida this year. What a soul winner he is. Our goal is to win people to the Lord 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Our goal for this year was to win 5,000 people to Jesus Christ during 2018 as of May 31st. By the glorious grace of God, we've seen 3,732 people come to the Lord. Our goal was to start 12 churches. By the grace of God, we've already started 14 churches during this year. So we now have 54 churches started in 55 and a half months, to which we praise God for. I'm just saying all of that to say this. When you talk about missions, we live it, we breathe it, it's important, it's not a game, it's not a vacation, it's not traveling, it's in all the glamour of it all. Because if you go with us, you'll work about 18 hours every day, every single day. So, Pastor, if you'd kind of share what you're going to share, don't worry about it, because I'm going to condense mine tonight, because I want to hear what you have to say. Okay.
Take your Bible tonight and turn to John chapter 3. John chapter 3. Many of us, I would guess, tonight can quote John 3:16, right? And that says what? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Have you ever taken a look at John 3:17? Verse 17 says, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. I have one question tonight. Why is the world not saved? Why is the world not saved? I have three reasons that I believe the world is not saved. Number one, Satan. Satan is the biggest cause in the world not being saved. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 4, the Bible says, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. Church, we are light bearers in Lebanon, Indiana, Boone County, in the state of Indiana. Brother Kilgore, men and women, boys and girls, just like him, who forsake home and country and go other places, are light bearers, as I said last night, in our place, the places we cannot go, or like you're like me, places you will not go. I said last night, if God wants me to go to Africa, he's going to have to put out a neon sign that says, David Dale, go to Africa, with an arrow pointing. Okay? If God tells me to go, I'll go. He told me to come to Walnut Street Baptist Church. Here we are. We did not let the devil derail us in coming here. He tried. He will try anything and everything he can. Why? Because he wants to keep as many people as he can captive and take them to a literal place called hell for all eternity. And that's why you and I have to come to grips with these, with the fact that there are people out there, working against us, and we have to work for the cause of Christ. We have to, as the song says, work for the night is coming when man works no more. We know the time is short. We know that we're living in the last of the last days. But why are we sitting on our comfortable pews letting people die and go to hell every day? Because the devil, Satan, has tricked us into that. Secondly, another reason that the world is not saved is self. Ourself. Mark 8:34 tells us, and when he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. It is not easy to serve God. And all too often, we let me get in the way. I'm guilty too. How many doors have I knocked on in 2018 and 11? Zero. And I'm ashamed of that. I'm saying it publicly. I am absolutely ashamed of myself because I have not gotten out there. But church, I'm not going to go by myself. Okay? I'm just being honest with you. Because it doesn't matter if you're guilty. All somebody has to do in this day, in this hour, is make an accusation and you're guilty until proven innocent. So what I'm trying to do with having this missions conference, yes, I'm trying to motivate us to partner up with missionaries like the Kilgores and the Ruwersmiths, the Rulies, and the Moors. And you can consider Dale Tilley a home missionary. He's in Alaska, or actually he may not be in Alaska right now. He may be in the air somewhere on his way home. That's why we partner with people like this, because we've got to get the gospel out. But each individual person cannot do it themselves. We can, when we go to Steak and Shake, we can give a gospel tract. When we go to the grocery store, we can hand out a gospel tract. Church, we've got to quit being afraid of handing out gospel tracts. Hand out those God's simple plan of salvation. My name's on it. Let them call the church and complain. I can handle it. I've got broad shoulders and a big smile, and I can take care of it. I'm used to handling the problem. It just doesn't bother me. We have been called to take the gospel. We are to do, one man said, we are to bloom where we are planted. And all too many times in our lives, we let Satan get in the way. We listen to lies he tells us in our ears. We let ourselves get in the way. But God, you know, it's 190 degrees out there, and I'm going to melt. Or, you know, God, my sciatic nerve is killing me. I really just like to lay down and cry right now. Or my... broke my fingernail. We're guilty of it. We all are, including myself. Church, I'm not preaching at you, I'm preaching to us. I'm just as guilty of this stuff as anybody else is. This is a reminder to me that I'm letting these things slip, that it's time for me to get up off my pew and do something for the cause of Christ, because every day, thousands upon thousands of people are more stepping out into eternity without him than are going with him. When we stand before God, we are going to receive rewards and we are going to lose rewards based on what we have done for him. And I don't want to lose reward because I was too stinking lazy to get out and share the gospel with somebody. Lastly, number three, the reason why the world is not saved, it's just plain sin. Romans 6, 1 and 2 tells us, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer? Romans 5, 12 tells us, wherefore is by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. We're all sinners. We are all sinners, but that just because there's a bunch of sinners out there, we cannot let ourselves be stopped in sharing the gospel. They are sick with sin, and you and I have the cure for what they suffer from. How stinking selfish is it when somebody has a cure for a disease and they won't share it with the very people that are sick? Guess what, church? The church is no different. I know churches today that refuse to do any kind of outreach. They want to have their programs and their sports programs and this and that and the other. Oh, we'll live our testimony out before him. Baloney, that is only part of it. Believe me, the devil is taking his game to them. Church, it is high time that the Church of Jesus Christ rise up and take the game to the lost and dying world that is out there. They are dying to see real Christian people sharing the real gospel of Christ with them. I only have one more question. Will you? Will you? Mr. I come to the end. You know, we're gonna sing a song here just so we can stand up, and Ms. Tara's gonna sing a special song. But I want you to think about that. What are we doing for the cause of Christ? Why do we yoke up with missionaries like the Gilmores and those that we support? Why? Because turn to page 539. We're rescuing the perishing. Page 539. Stand with me as we sing. Yeah.
very much. All right, open your Bibles, if you would, please, to Romans chapter 10. Tonight, what I'm going to do is preach the introduction, and then tomorrow night I'll preach the message, okay? And because I want to make sure that you get it. I don't want to miss any of it. So tomorrow we'll just go expositorily and share 5 points. But tonight, just want to share a thought. How will they know if we do not go? What do you think about that? Did you hear that? How will they know if we do not go? Father in heaven, everyone here today has gone to Europe. They have gone to Togo, Africa, and they've gone also to Brazil, South America, through the three missionaries that the church supports. And because of their faithful giving and hopefully faithful praying, these missionaries are there experiencing some good results because they answered the call to give up everything and to go to these countries. And in so doing, this church and others that are supporting them have now become partners with them so that what they accomplish, Lord, will be charged. We know that you're going to charge that to this church's account. But I hope that it goes much deeper. I hope that the hurts they have, we make them our hurts. The things that they rejoice about, I hope that we will rejoice with them because we pray for them, because we sacrificially give to be able to help them. But Lord, I think about all the missionaries that was called to go but did not go, maybe because of a lack of financial support, maybe because of discouragement. Lord, there's many reasons. Maybe they went to do a mission trip and they realized once they got there, it's not America. And believe me, it's not. Lord, when you go there, you give up a lot. Nothing for me. I don't consider anything a sacrifice there for me. But I know that families sacrifice a lot. They sacrifice their Wi-Fi. They sacrifice many times their very important conveniences that we have and luxuries of life that we have taken for granted. Even like going to a faucet and turning a faucet on and having safe water come out. Many people have to get a gallon or 2 gallon containers and send their children 2 or 3 miles down to a dirty river and get out rusty water. And that child or children will carry it on their shoulder the 2 or 3 miles back home. So Lord, help us to remember these missionaries. Help us to remember that though they're excited about going, reality sets in when you get there because of you often feel all alone. You feel like everybody's forgotten about you. And that's why it's good to send a note or send a little care package once in a while to say, hey, we're excited about what you're doing. We're reading your prayer letters every month in church, and we just were so blessed. We just wanted to maybe be able to live a blessing to you and send you this perfume that Bonnie was talking about, or maybe some coloring books for the children or crayons. So Lord, tonight I pray as we speak that may we just get away from, oh, here's another meeting. Lord, may we say, it's time that we return to our first love. And the first love, Lord, is just like the church of Ephesus in Ephesians 2, 1 through 7. A church that 30 years earlier, you commended them for their serving fervor and missionary activity and many things. But after 30 short years, they left it. Lord, they willingly left it. And you who stood in the church and stand in this church, you had a message for them, a message to us as well, and I say us. And we're to remember from which we're following. And we are to repent. And we're to repeat our first works. And then, Lord, bless this church like this church maybe has never seen in all of its history. Lord, I know that when we get serious about missions, we're as close to the heart of God probably as a church we're going to get. Because missions is so many. Missions is evangelism. Mm-hmm. Missions is faith. Missions is praying. Missions is trusting you. And even as we challenged last night, as we taught on what is faith promise missions giving, I hope that people started praying, started talking in their family. As the Lord laid anything on your heart, I don't know, not yet, but maybe a little bit in mind. Mm-hmm. Let's pray a little bit more about what God would be able to trust God to do through our family during 2018 through June of 2019. Mm-hmm. Holy Spirit, in these next 20, 25 minutes. And then when we have the invitation, maybe not sit, but maybe be moved by the Spirit of God. Not so that we can count and say, oh, that we had 7 people at the altar, 20 people at the altar. Lord, we don't care about that, neither do you. What we care about is to see a movement of God start in our hearts and revival in our hearts for this area of missions and evangelism and so on. So we commit the service to you. Please bless. Amen. Romans chapter 10, we're going to speak on the subject. How will they know if they do not go? How are they going to know? Now, I want you to think for a moment. Heaven is a real literal place. Do you agree with that?
Amen.
Heaven is a place right now where the streets are soft, the river of life flows down through heaven to the throne of God. Heaven is a place where my first wife is there, my dad is there, my mom is there, Kathy's mom is, or Bonnie's mom is there, Bonnie's dad is there, my first wife's mother is there, and her father just went to be with the Lord about 2 months ago. Heaven's a real place. And heaven's a wonderful place, isn't it? Some of us, because of our age, we're not too far away from going to heaven. I'm going to tell you that right now. The Lord said that we normally will live 70, which is 70 years. And I'm 64. That means that if I live to be 70, I have 6 years left, maybe. Or if it takes me before, maybe he gives me overtime. Maybe I live to be 87, like my dad. I don't know. But the truth is, we need to be thinking about heaven. And if you really believe heaven's a real place, why wouldn't we want to take as many people as possible with us? Why wouldn't we? Why wouldn't we be out there sharing the gospel? Why wouldn't we be passing out tracts? Why wouldn't we be praying as a church specifically for people to get saved? Why wouldn't we as a church be praying, God, help us to have more missionaries that can go and represent us, not just on 3 continents, but Lord, make it our goal to reach all 7 continents for the glory of God. Now, I'm going to tell you, I will never forget what Pastor Dale said up here a moment ago about not going out. You know how humbling that was for him to say that? That's why I love and respect him. He's honest. You know, you talk about transparency. We saw it there, didn't we? Amen? You think that's easy for a preacher to get up and say, church, I haven't knocked on 1 door during the first 6.5 months of this year? What did he follow it up with? He wants somebody to go. Why not you? Why wouldn't you go with him? Well, missions is great around the world, but missions has to start right here in our own Jerusalem.
Right.
And then you go to your Judea, which is the state, and Samaria, which is America, and then the uttermost parts of the world as you add missionaries on to go to those places that you cannot go maybe at this time, or maybe never get to go. But as we read Romans chapter 10, I will give you a great expository outline tomorrow night. Tonight I just want to give you what's on my heart by way of introduction. In verse 13, the Bible says, for whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord, what? Shall be saved. It didn't say you might be saved. It did not say that if we take the gospel to those people in India or Bangladesh or the Philippines or Zimbabwe, Africa or Uganda or Kenya, it didn't say they might be saved. We have a definite promise here. They shall be saved. Amen. No doubt about it. When you're saved, the Bible word for saved means to be delivered from danger. It means that a person is not going to go to hell like they were, but when they place their faith in Jesus Christ and Him alone, God said, I'm going to save you from that danger and the eternal torments of hell, and I'm going to allow you to come into this wonderful place that I call heaven. Now, the Bible says, whosoever. That means anybody that you come into contact with, anybody that I come across in all my travels around the world, I have the complete assurance that Jesus Christ loves them, Jesus Christ died for them, and Jesus Christ can save them if they will only call upon Him.
Amen.
Verse 14. How then shall they call on Him, that is Jesus, in whom they have not believed? How are they going to do it? How are they going to place their faith in Jesus Christ if they really don't know who He is? You'd be surprised at the number of people that do not understand Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They see Him, as I said last night in India, they see Him as an idol, as one of 330 million that they can choose to worship in the land of India. They see Him as a great teacher. I heard that for years, but it's the truth. Oh yes, Jesus, He was a master teacher. He was a prophet. Get this. They say, He's one of the sons of God. But for some reason, because of the failure of the church, because of the failure of our Christianity in America and other parts of the world, we have failed to proclaim Jesus Christ as the Son of God, the sinless Son of God, that left heaven, came to this world, lived a sinless life, went to that cross, and there on the cross, He paid the sin debt for everyone that would ever live. And all they have to do is hear the gospel, accept the gospel, receive Jesus Christ. And He said in verse 13, I promise you, I will save them.
Amen.
There's no one that's going to come to Jesus that's going to say, oh, you know what? You're too bad of a sinner. I don't think that I can save you. That'll never happen. Any and all that comes to Jesus Christ can and will be saved if they're looking to Jesus Christ and Him alone.
Amen.
But they have to believe. Do you understand that? They have to place their faith in Jesus Christ. That's what verse 14 says. How then shall they call on Him in whom they have not believed? Second question. And how shall they believe in Him of whom they have not heard? In other words, how can people who don't know who Jesus Christ is, how can they call upon Him? How can you call upon someone that you really don't know what in the world He did for you? There's no way that they can call upon Jesus Christ and say, oh, I know Jesus Christ paid for my sin when He shed His blood there upon the cross of Calvary. There's no way. If someone doesn't know, share the gospel with them.
Right.
Now, I'm going to give you some wisdom here, Pastor, from experience. When you have missionaries come in, ask the question, how many people have you led to Jesus Christ in the last year? How many people have you led to Jesus Christ in the last month? How many people have you led to Jesus Christ in the last week? Now, please understand, I'm not putting pressure on them that they have to try and, how can I say this word? Putting pressure on them that everybody's going to be this great soul winner. But here's what my point is. If you're not winning souls here at home or even trying to win souls here at home, what makes you think that when you go to a Middle Eastern country that suddenly you're going to become this super spiritual soul winner? In Lafayette, Indiana, about 5 years ago, I met with a man. Him and his wife were on deputation with a great mission board. And And so I heard about it, and I said, you know, I'm going to take him out and try to be an encouragement to him. So I took him to Chick-fil-A there, I think off of State Road 26 in Lafayette. And I sat down with him and said, tell me about your ministry. And the more I listened to him, the more I realized I have no idea what this guy is doing for God. He's out there, he has support, raising support. And finally, after about 50 minutes, I asked a question, Brother Al. Tell me something. When's the last time you led someone to Jesus Christ? He about swallowed that whole chicken. He didn't expect that. And I said, I don't mean to make you feel uncomfortable, but tell me. I sat here for 50 minutes with a missionary, and I've never heard you once talk about leading anybody to Jesus Christ or even trying, see what I'm saying, qualifying, or even trying to win somebody to Jesus Christ. I said, what do you do in your church? I said, do you preach? No. Do you teach Sunday school? No. So what do you do in your church? Oh, I'm in charge of the Sunday school teachers. I said, so where's, do you go visiting? No. I said, what are you going to do when you get to the mission field? And he's going to a Middle Eastern country, Muslim country. Here's what he said. I will sit down and I will reason with them. I said, they'll reason and cut your head off before you get done reasoning.
Right.
Your reasoning is not going to win them to Jesus Christ. It's going to be the preaching and the teaching of the Word of God, sharing Jesus Christ, preaching Jesus Christ, letting them know that Jesus Christ is your only hope. Then you say, oh, that's easy for you to say. Can I say this by the grace of God to give Him the glory? We have seen this year about 800 Muslims get saved.
Amen.
So I know what I'm talking about. You see, they have a religion of hate.
Right.
And when you tell them about Jesus Christ and how He loves them and what that love led Him to do for them, you've got their attention.
Right.
And there we've been able to see these Muslims come to Jesus Christ in record numbers for our ministry. It started off with women getting Muslims getting saved. But in this last year, this year, I'd venture to say probably a good 50 to 60% have been men.
Amen.
Muslim men coming to Jesus Christ. So you find out what they're doing. You know what I told the preacher, the missionary, and I was doing a favor? I said, you've got two choices, son. I said, no, and it's called son, he's like 25, 26 years of age. I said, you've got one of two choices, son. You can either go back to your church and say, Pastor, let's go solo. Or you do the decent thing and quit trying to raise support and take money from churches who think that you're going to go and represent them by winning souls. So find out what these people are doing. Find out what their objectives are. Well, how shall they hear? And have they not heard? So our responsibility is to share the gospel. And how shall they hear without a preacher, in verse 14, or a messenger? God has chosen to use people to take the gospel of Jesus Christ, open the Word of God, and ask this question, sir, if you were to die today, are you 100% sure that you would go to heaven? Or, remember I taught you that? Or would you have to say, I just don't know. I just don't know. I've had people say, yeah, it's easy to win people to go to other countries. Oh, really? Have you ever been to a country? No. Then don't say it. Don't say it if you haven't been there. Let me ask you this. They tell her, before I ask, here's what they said. They said, oh, yeah, but you just can't do that in America anymore. Can I tell you that we have a pastor's son last year, how old? Judge. 11 years old, won over 90 people to Jesus Christ. Can you say amen once in a while?
Amen.
I'd say an 11-year-old kid that inspired his ninth, 9-year-old brother that this year has probably won 35 or 40 people to the Lord. In America, someone told me the other day, or what, not the other day, probably 2 or 3 weeks ago, said, "Yeah, but you don't win anybody to the Lord in America, do you?" And I said, "I can tell you this, and brag on God, I cannot remember the last time I've ever gone soul winning in America that at least one person has not got saved. I'm telling you the truth. I cannot remember. You know why? Because it's not about me. It's about the Christ of the Bible."
Amen.
You share Jesus Christ. You walk up there confident in Jesus Christ. And you walk up to these people and say, "Why should I be afraid of them? I mean, what are they going to do? Are they going to scout me? Brother A? There. Okay. They can't scout us. I'm not afraid of them. Why should I be afraid of them? What are they going to do? I'm just too busy." "Okay, I'm sorry to hear that. Well, I can give you this track." No, not interested. "Okay, well, I appreciate that. Hopefully, maybe sometime somebody else will come by and they'll visit you." And then you go on. You know, I've learned the value of shaking the dust off of your feet and understanding.